2 Kings chapter number 6. We're going to start at verse number 8. Those of you that want to stand for the reading of the word, you can always stand for the reading of the word. Those of you that can't stand, that's okay, but everybody should stand for the reading of the word. Amen. Amen. 2 Kings chapter number 6. This morning, the series of messages called The Matrix. The reason why I wanted to talk about The Matrix, matrix is a Latin word that means womb. Matrix also is the infrastructure that formulates and molds people into binary figures that walk, that cross each other. If you've ever seen the movie The Matrix, how many people have ever seen the movie The Matrix? Amen. There are a lot of symbolisms that we can take from it. As a matter of fact, there are a lot of symbolisms in the movie. But I want to talk about what the matrix from the definition that Morpheus gave in the movie was that it is a system that molds people into become a battery. And he said, he would go on and say, I can't explain the matrix. You have to see it for yourself. It is really kind of a post-cursor to The Wizard of Oz. Now, I know everybody has seen The Wizard of Oz, whether you see the one the one with Dorothy in Kansas, or you watch the one with Diana Ross and Michael Jackson, you've seen some version of The Wizard of Oz. And you remember at the end of The Wizard of Oz, they get to the end and realize that the wizard wasn't what they thought. In the same light, as believers, we live between two realities. There is this sensing that you walk in the flesh, but that there is something behind what you see that when you're not saved, you really can't put your finger on it, but you know that there's something there. And it isn't until you get saved or you've been exposed to some teaching on spiritual warfare that you begin to realize more about the demonic realm or the devil. The Bible teaches very explicitly that there are three realms, there are three heavens that the Bible talks about. There is the upper heaven, which is the clouds and the sky. There is the universe, the stars and the moon, which is the second heaven. And the third heaven is the place where God's throne is. But we also understand that there is a cosmic conflict going on between light and dark. So we walk between two realities, and what we're going to talk about today, between two realities, we see it pictured in 2 Kings chapter 6, where Elisha, not Elijah, he took over the ministry, the successor of Elijah, is dealing with the conflict, and there's some interesting points that I want to bring out this morning, and there's some things that I want to see in light of what's going down in our country with justice and injustice, and how do we as the church address it? Because this is what's on the mouths and the tongues of a lot of people, is how do we respond to all of the injustice in the world, and especially as it pertains to us as black people. But if you don't realize, and if you're not careful, you will make people your enemy and not deal with the enemy of your soul, which causes you to misdirect your energies at the wrong person. And so you can get caught up in looking at a person and thinking that that person is your enemy, when the reality is that person is not your enemy, but who is your enemy is what you got to deal with. Now, I'm going to make this statement in the beginning. I'll probably follow up and say it again. Understand something. As a church or as Christians, people are not our enemy. Farrakhan ain't our enemy. The LGBT is not our enemy. Fraternities, sororities, any group are not our enemy. What makes a person, I don't want to use the word enemy, but what makes a person contrary to us is a belief system. Whenever you get involved in any organization, sorority, fraternity, group, church, activity, don't make no difference. If they minimize Jesus to a human, you have just come against the very core of what Christianity is about. And you moved into the realm of what the Bible calls in 1 John 2, the spirit of Antichrist, or the spirit of anti instead of Christ. And what you got to realize that humanism is designed to make man the center and move Jesus out. So anything that causes you to be puffed up above Christ now becomes warfare. Because now the war is to put humanity in its right place, its need for a Savior, and put Jesus back on the throne. And whenever you run into conflicts, it's because there is a mindset that has made the human mind or humanity God and push God away. So we're going to read the Bible, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse, starting at verse number 8. We're going to read a little bit because I'm going to read down to verse 23. Just follow along. I'm reading from the NLT. You know, we like reading the NLT because it's a lot simpler, makes it plain, and does not lose the canon of Scripture, which is that Jesus must be found all the way through Scripture. Always remember the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. We're going to do a little studying today. Next couple of weeks, we're going to get into some stuff. But just follow me. I told you, bring your pothead friends with you next week. Amen. Tell them this is a no-judgment zone. They can go back home and start. But we're going to give them something to think about. Listen to what the Bible says. When the king of Aram was at war with Israel, somebody say conflict, he would confer with his officers and say, we will mobilize our officers at such and such a place. But immediately, Elisha, the man of God, would warn the king of Israel, do not go near that place, for the Arameans are planning to mobilize their troops there. So the king of Israel would send word to the place indicated by the man of God. Somebody say the man of God. Time and again, Elisha warned the king so that he would be on the alert there. The king of Aram became very upset over this. He called his officers together and demanded, which of you is a traitor? Who has been informing the king of Israel of my plan? It's not us, my lord, the king, one of the officers replied. Elisha, the prophet in Israel, tells the king of Israel even the words you speak in the privacy of your bedroom. Somebody say, with God, there is no privacy. Why? Because whatever's done in the dark will be revealed in the light. Verse 13, go and find out where he is, the king commanded, so I can send troops to seize him. And the report came back, Elisha is at Dothan. So one night the king of Aram sent a great army with many chariots and horses to surround the city. Now watch this. When the servant of the man of God got up early the next morning, somebody say early, and went outside, there were troops, horses, and chariots everywhere. Oh, sir, this is the servant, I like this. Oh, sir, what will we do now? The young man cried to Elijah. Somebody say, fear. Don't be afraid. Elijah told him, for there are more on our side than on theirs. Then Elijah prayed, oh, Lord, open his eyes and let him see. The Lord opened the young man's eyes, and when he looked up, he saw that the hillside around Elisha was filled with horses and chariots of fire. And the Arminian army advanced toward him. Elisha prayed, oh Lord, please make them blind. So the Lord struck them with blindness as Elisha had asked. Then Elijah went out and told them, you've come the wrong way. This isn't the right city. Follow me. Now they're blind. They don't know where they're going. Follow me and I will take you to the man you're looking for. And he led them to the city of Samaria. How can you be blind and follow somebody? As soon as they had entered Samaria, Elijah prayed, "Oh Lord, now open their eyes and let them see." So the Lord opened their eyes and they discovered that they were in the middle of Samaria. Imagine fighting somebody. You got to fight with somebody. And you end up right in the middle of their territory. As soon as they had entered Samaria, Elijah prayed, "Oh Lord, now open their eyes and let them see." Now, here's the paradox in this. They were blind, but they could follow. The servant saw, but he didn't see. When the king of Israel saw them, he shouted to Elijah, "My father, should I kill them? Should I kill them?" "Of course not," Elijah replied. "Do we kill prisoners of war, give them food and drink, and send them home again to their master?" So the king made a great feast for them and then sent them home to their master. After that, the Arminian raiders, watch this, stayed away from the land of Israel. Lord, bless the reading of your word. Bless this time. God, anoint me to teach this word and to break it down according to your plan and your purposes. Father, I thank you and I bless you, and I give you the glory and the honor for what you're getting ready to do. So, Father, I pray that no matter how anointed I am, anoint your hearers to hear, to receive a word engrafted into their soul that will cause them to grow, that will cause them to think, that will cause them to be able to defend their faith, to be able to walk out and to win the spiritual battle that we all enter into on a daily basis. Let this word empower them. Let this word free them. Let this word encourage them and build them up and strengthen them for your glory and for your honor. Lord, I thank you and I bless you today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, what I want you to do is, as you're seated, I want you to understand the context of what's getting ready to go on, and I want us to look at some things from just the periphery. First of all, this battle was against the king of Aram. Aram metaphorically means intellect. Aram means intellect, and it poses the question that intellect should not ever be negated. Meaning your ability to be able to think should never be negated as a believer. Some people think faith and Christianity is a thoughtless religion. They think we just follow the whimsical whims of any old thing, and thereby we don't think, we don't comprehend, and we don't deal with the realities of life. But faith is something that must be studied, it must be understood, it must be dealt with on a day-to-day basis, because faith is to trust and to have confidence in God, his nature and his character. So therefore, you must study God's word to understand who God is, to realize what he is and what he is not. You can't go by what your grandmama them told you. You can't go by what everybody tells you. You can't even always go by what I tell you. You got to go back and study to show yourself approved, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You must research. You must understand history. You must understand the context of the passages. You must define words and look at words and understand how those words play out, because what some words in English mean does not always equate to the Hebrew equivalent of the Old Testament and Greek in the New Testament, and therefore the subsequent translation or how it lives itself out in reality. Aram is intellect, but it is intellect disconnected from the divine. Because you can be intelligent but have no connection with God. Hello. You can be smart and you can have many degrees, but the degrees do not equate to you having an ongoing relationship with God. Touch somebody and say relationship. On Wednesday night, we're dealing with destiny. We're dealing with destiny. And I would encourage you to come out or to get the CDs. That's what I was going to tell you. I forgot. Please buy these CDs, because there's some stuff that we're teaching on Wednesdays that is going down that you need to get the CDs if you're not going to come. But I would encourage you to come out to West Bowie Community Center and be a part of Bible study, because we're talking about destiny. In destiny is a calling, and it is a journey to something that God has for you in this life. Destiny along with purpose and vision is important, because if you don't know your purpose and you don't understand and see what God has for you, you're going to walk around blind even though you can see. But Aram is a place of intellect but without God. And so they come to the people of God and want to fight them, watch this, over their God. All conflicts that we are going to deal with from this point, from the cross until he comes back, is over your God. Please hear that. The Battle of Armageddon. At the end of the tribulation period, we're going to talk about the timeline of the church in these last days. We're going to talk about that in the next couple weeks. But you're going to find that the Battle of Armageddon at the end of the tribulation period, that 3.5 years, is over war, over belief, over God. ISIS is a group of people who don't believe in the Christian God. The rise of the Nation of Islam is against your belief in Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ is not a divine son of God. He was just a prophet. All that you're seeing now and all the conflict is over. Who do you believe and whom are you going to believe? Hello. You can try to make it a white-black issue, but I'm going to talk about something that is not a white-black issue. It is the issue of removing the Ten Commandments, the Bible, the Christian faith out of the lives of people. And it is about creating a group of people, the have-nots, to serve the have. That the father of public education, I'm going to talk about this a little bit more, his whole thesis and theory was to remove parents out of the lives of children so that there can be created a workforce for the have. When you read the Bible in the book of Revelation, the Bible says the small and the great. There is no middle. There is no middle. There's small and there is great. So when you begin to see that this battle happened in Aram, it happened in a place of intellect, the battle of intellect. Intellect without God. Because they end up in a place called Samaria. Watch this. Samaria meaning choice, meaning that with laws and commands, you have to choose between serving God or serving your intellect. And here this battle is taking place. And watch this. The king of Israel says, should we kill him? He says, no, don't kill him, because I told you, you need your intellect. You can't kill your intellect. You have to take him back to God, so he feeds him. But let me get to the rest of the story, because the person that has to open their eyes is Elisha. Watch this. Write this down in your notes. Elisha means God is Savior or God is Deliverer. God is Savior and God is Deliverer. So through this man, just like Neo, the chosen one, the prophet, the man of God, watch this, two things you need to understand. The Bible says that God does nothing unless he first reveals it to his servants, the prophets. All the school of prophets folks should know that. God does nothing unless he reveals it first to his servants, the prophets. In other words, in this hour, God, watch this, Elisha is a type, they say, of Christ. He's going to come before Jesus. In other words, God is going to raise up some men and women who are going to operate in the world of intellect, but bring Christ in to show them the real deal. Just like in the Matrix, some folk need to get unplugged from the world so that they can really see what the world really is. So let's get in this a little bit more. Can we use the Bible this morning? Is that all right? Go with me to Ephesians chapter, before we get back into 2 Kings, go with me to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11, because I want you to see something. Ephesians chapter 6, NLT. I'm staying with the NLT all day, baby. Ephesians 6, verse 11. When you're there, say amen. We're going to use the Bible this morning, so you're going to stay with me? Amen. I'm on clock today. All right. Now, Sister Patrice did a great job on the Arm of God a couple weeks ago. You should get that CD. It's only $5. I'm gonna do plugs all day long, so get used to it. But listen to what it says. Verse 11. Put on all of God's armor. Relationship. The armor is relationship. Got to have relationship. Destiny is always categorized, or no, I'm not categorized, it's symbolized by relationship. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to what? Stand firm against all, say it with me, strategies of the devil. Uh-oh. And y'all did not say it with me. That's why I was looking at y'all. I wasn't stopping. I said, say it with me. Stand firm against all the strategies of, stand firm against all the, of, stand firm against all of, whose strategies? Diametrically opposed against God's plan for your life. Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plan that I have, says the Lord. Thoughts of, and not of, to give you a what? A sound mind or expected end. I love it. I love it. My students in the house today. But the devil got a strategy against you. Hello? I want that to just simmer a little bit, because you got to understand why you need relationship with God. Because, see, when you talk to your friends and they're like, well, why should I become a Christian? Because the devil has a plan for you. Just like God has a plan for you. But you got to choose. So if you get intellectually involved in the culture, in the society, in the matrix, it will mold you to use you, but use you for the wrong purpose. All the strategies. Watch this. Watch this. Let's go through some scriptures, because look at what Jesus said. Let's go to John chapter 14. I just got so many scriptures, so I'm just going to go. Watch this. John chapter 14. No, it's John 18. I'm sorry. John 18, verse number 36. Now, watch this, because this is one I'm going to get a little soapboxy, but just stay with me. Jesus answered, my kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. My kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. If it were, my followers would fight to keep me from being hand it over to the Jewish leaders, but my kingdom is not of this world. Oh, Pastor Payne, what you just said. Oh, okay. Go to Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. There you go. Colossians chapter 1, verse number 13. Thank you for that. If I'm not clear, could you say that again, please? Can't hear you. Colossians chapter 1, verse number 13. When you're there, say amen. Come on, let's move, people. Move, people. Let's go. Y'all moving slow. Let's go. Help me out. For he has rescued us from the kingdom of what? And transferred us into the kingdom of what? His dear son. Now go back to what we just said out of John. John 18 says, my kingdom is not of this world. You have been transferred from darkness to the kingdom of his son. So therefore, you can't operate like everybody else in the world, because you're no longer in that system that's operating around you. 2 Corinthians then. Y'all looking at me like I'm crazy. No, this is hitting some people. 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. Now watch this. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 7. This is the NLT. So now listen, y'all can quote this in y'all sleep. We walk by, not by. Okay, but look at what the NLT says. For we live by believing, not by seeing. For we live by believing, not by seeing. So here's the question. When you and your spouse are going at it, what do you believe? When you're trying to find someone in your life, what do you believe? When you're on your job and you're trying to get ahead, what do you believe? When somebody does you wrong, what do you believe? We walk by faith, not by sight, or we walk by believing, not by seeing. Go back to 2 Kings. Don't go there, but go back in your mind. Elijah and his servant are surrounded by the intellectuals. The intellectuals without God. And he says, what are we going to do? And he says, first thing he does is pray. Lord, help him see. And when he sees, what does he see? Horses and chariots. Now, let me tell you why that don't make no sense to you. Because you don't remember how Elijah was delivered. It was a horse and a chariot that delivered him and carried him away. What does that mean, horse and a chariot, fiery horse and chariot? That means, first of all, second point, is that not only did he pray that his dude's eyes would be open, but now he showed him how he was going to be delivered, but he showed him that it's more with him than it is with them. See, some of us get afraid because we feel outnumbered. We feel a sense of fear of rejection if we bring God or Christ into the situation. We feel intimidated, not realizing, okay, close your eyes for a minute. Close your eyes, close your eyes, close your eyes. Lord, in every situation, help them to see what they can't see and believe that what they see is true. In Jesus' name, amen. Open your eyes. See, you have to open your eyes to the realm of the Spirit to understand that there's more with you than it is with them. Go back to Ephesians chapter number 6 again. Ephesians 6. It would help if I put my glasses on. I got my glasses in my hand. Ephesians chapter 6. Look at this. Look at this. Ephesians 6. Man. Now watch this. So the strategies of the devil. Verse number 12. For we are not fighting against what? Enemies. Finish that thought. But we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies. So stop fighting people. Stop fighting people. White people are not devils. I heard a spoken word. And on spoken word, the girl said, how come we only rise up when it's police? Why don't we rise up when it's our own killing our own? Why we only get on the Word Network and have Farrakhan on the Word Network when it's the police and we call that injustice, but when we gonna start calling black on black crime injustice? Let me tell you something. Farrakhan got on Word Network, no disrespect to the minister, respect him highly, one of the voices of black America, but he's wrong on something. He said this: pastors need to stop teaching their people to forgive. Because in doing so, we're teaching them how to become slaves of the system. Let me tell you something. We're already slaves of a system. And yeah, I'm going to teach you how to forgive, to be a bondservant of Christ. Because one of the biggest problems we have in the church is too many people are holding on to grudges. Therefore, the Bible says in Matthew, if you don't forgive, then God can't forgive you. That's some of the reason why some people are real agitated in church, is because they've been cut off from the lifeline that is Christ. Because until you come to a place to forgive, God can't forgive you. Well, is that Bible, Pastor? Yes, it is. Hold up. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. Verse number 32. But wait a minute now, because we got to deal with an issue here. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. Instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. You need to underline that. A lot of y'all need to underline that. Married folk need to underline this. Instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. Okay, watch this. Because here's the tension in what's going on in America today. We are taught by scriptures to obey all authority that has been placed over us. But here's the question, because this came up in Friday night conversation. But what do you do when that authority goes the wrong way? What happens when they start racially profiling you? What happens when a policeman puts his hands on you for no reason? This is what has black America upset, because we've been taught, and even in the civil rights movement, we've been taught to turn the other cheek. We've been taught to not go against that. But wait a minute. That's not necessarily what Jesus taught. When Jesus first sends his disciples out, he says, take nothing with you. But when Jesus goes, he changes. He says, take a purse, take a belt. Oh, and by the way, take the sword with you. See, there is a dualation and a tension that one must realize. Watch this, because this is where relationship and understanding help you. Jesus did not fight back because he had to die. When they were trying to kill Jesus on the hill, he wouldn't let them kill him because he said, it is not my time. So he walked through it. So until it's time for you to die, Jesus teaches, don't go. Resist unless it's time for you to die. It's not resisting that's the problem. It's how do you resist? If a man is putting his hands on you, you should leave. If a woman throws hot grits on you, you should leave. If a person is not taking care of their responsibilities, they gotta go. If a policeman is putting his hands on me, and there are more than one policeman, you need to ball up and protect yourself, get a good lawyer, and sue him. Now, I want to share this as an addendum, as a sidebar, because I'm going to get back into this. one of the ladies that came, one of the young ladies that came to the Friday night conversation brought this out, and I thought it was some good piece of information. One night she was driving home, and a police officer in the district pulled her over. When she wouldn't roll her window down and give the white officer her information, he called 5 more police officers, 10 total. And there were 10 officers and one black woman in the car by herself. In a dark place, in a very dim place. And when she wrote the attorney, state's attorney general, the person that talked to her said, what you should have did was call 911, tell them you were feeling very uncomfortable and being harassed, and you shouldn't have stopped until you got to a well-lit area. And if anybody's in this room and you come across that, because a police officer must give you probable cause before they search your car. But if you speed, then they have probable cause. But move to a place that's safe. Move to a place where people can see you. And always remember, unless they give you probable cause, you do not have to get in. Call 911. Why are there 10 cops and I'm one woman? Why are there 10 cops on my car? If I'm a black man and you don't have a probable cause, you just want to pull me over, then call 911. I'm trying to figure out right now, why are there 20 cops on my tail? Do I have a warrant out on me? What's going on? But if I don't, see, here's the thing that you and I got to learn. You can't give people cause to mess with you. If you give them cause, then they can do it. Pay your tickets, deal with your fines so that they can't pull you over for any old reason. Okay, well, then let me get back to this. Okay, amen. But we need to understand our rights. And part of it, if we're dealing on two realities, you got to know what your rights and authorities are in the earth as it applies to you as a believer. It does not mean that now you in the earth, but you got to disappear and can't be relevant to understand how I'm going to operate. Not that God is against blessing you and giving you stuff, but do you understand what keeps most people from getting blessed is the fact that God said if I give it to them, they don't even know what to do with it. Money without a purpose is money wasted. Money without a purpose is money wasted. Do you realize if I were to give you $5,000 today, by Wednesday it would be gone? All y'all lying. Don't shake your head at me talking about, nah, but. I'm going to tell you why. The only reason why some people shake their head is because they've blown $5,000 before. If you blew money, then you get some money, you start realizing, but you're going to blow some of that money. Okay, let me get back to this thing right here. Go watch this. Go to John 17 for a minute. John 17. You getting something out of this? All right, John 17. Go here for a minute. This is John. Somebody talk about the Lord's Prayer is Matthew chapter 9. Some people disagree with that. Most people believe the prayer of Jesus in John chapter 17 is the Lord's Prayer. Listen to what it says. Stay with me. I'm going to get ready to close this out. Listen to what it says. John 17, verse 11. Well, go to verse 9 for a minute because I want you to see this in context. My prayer is not for the world, but for those you have given me because they belong to you. All who are mine belong to you, and you have given them to me, so they bring, watch this, me glory. So therefore, Jesus is praying that all of us give him glory. Verse 11. Now I'm departing from the world. They are staying in this world. But I am coming to you, Holy Father. You have given me your name. Now protect them by the power of your name so that they will be united just as we are. So the name of Jesus, watch this, is not to use to name it and claim it. The name of Jesus is the character, the nature of God is what keeps you. When you understand his nature is all-consuming. His nature is love. His nature is fire. When you begin to understand the nature of God, you begin to understand how God operates. When you pray in Jesus' name, you're not praying that if you see somebody, I'm going to get that person. No. You're praying, God, help me understand your will as it pertains to that person. Help me understand what your desire is, because not my will be done, but your will be done. Now watch this. Go with me over to 14. John chapter 17, verse 14. I'm still in 17. I'm just going through some verses I want you to see. John chapter 17, verse 14. I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world. Just as I do not belong to the world, I am not asking you, watch this, I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is what? Which is what's truth? The word. Not facts. We regurgitate facts, not truth. Truth. It don't work. Truth. He lazy. Truth. We ain't got enough money. Truth. I mean, not truth. Fact. They lazy. Fact. They this. Fact. They that. See, the world teaches you how to be critical without truth, because we live in a world full of whatever your reality is, that's good for you. So we major on major criticism. Understand something. If you look at me long enough, you'll find all of my faults and failures. You understand what I'm saying? If I sit down and we talk, I can identify everything that's wrong with you. If I sit and all I'm doing is looking at you, look at his shoes, look at her pants, look at her dress, look at her hair. What's wrong with her today? Why is she dressed like that? Why is he doing that? Why is he saying that? We are hypercritical. It's killing our marriages because we are creating lists of what's wrong with a person. And if you ever go to counseling, first thing they're going to tell you is, well, what are some things that this person does well? But for the Christian, it's not a matter of fact. Because I see the fact. Fact. Yeah, there's a lot of blacks dying by white police officers. Fact. These times are getting tougher. Fact. Yeah, that person is sick. Fact. But truth, God is still a healer. Fact, God is still a provider. Fact, what's impossible with man is possible with God. Truth, I'm not fact, truth. Truth, God's a healer. Truth, God can heal. Truth, God can do the impossible. Truth, I gotta see the fact in order to apply the truth. Fact, my kids drive me crazy, but truth is they got a call on their life. So I have to feed their calling. See, we want to feed the fact, but we don't want to feed the truth. Because we want to feel self-justified because we believe what the world says. You're God. You're not God. Well, the Bible even says we're God. How do you deal with that? When it uses the word God in your life, it's the little G. You not the big G. So you may have the nature of the big G to make you a little G, but even the little G has to submit to the big G. Go back to John for a minute. Where am I? Okay, got a little bit of time. Just as verse 18. Make them holy, verse 17, make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is what? Ah, come on. Truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I'm sending them into the world. And I gave myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your. I am praying not only for those disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. Didn't that sound like Thriller? First John chapter number 5. Stay with me. Then we're going back to where I got a couple more scriptures. They're like, where does he get all this stuff from? Boy, watch too much TV. No, look at this. First John chapter 5, verse 18. Stay with me. First John chapter 5, verse 18. We know that God's children do not make a practice of sinning. Underline that. You can sin, but don't practice sinning. See, that's the difference. You can sin. We all sin. But be careful that you don't let that one sin become practice for the normality of sinning every day. Why? Because you're the children of God, and you should be reminded that what you're doing is wrong. Hello, somebody. You can't be nasty every day. You practice being nasty. You practicing being nasty. Every day should not be a fight. Every day should not be you fighting every day. There's something wrong. Somebody's practicing being confrontational. Verse 19. No. Make it a practice of sinning. For God's Son, watch this. For God's sons hold them securely, and the evil one cannot touch them. Now watch this. You're just coming out of John 17, remember. We know that we are the children of God, and that the world around us is under the control of who? The evil one. See, the world we live in is diametrically opposed. Cosmos, attitudes, mindset. See, that's where we miss it. When we talk about the world, we missing that we just looking at people, but we not looking at the attitude and the mindset and the opinions that are diametrically opposed to Christ and his word. So when I'm dealing with people, I'm going to show you a scripture. Okay, watch this. So go to 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Watch this. Then we're going to go to Revelation chapter 12. Well, I'm going to show you. Revelation chapter number 12. But we're going to 1 John chapter 2 first. I love what the NLT says. We almost finished, y'all. This is just an introduction. Y'all okay? 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love this what? Nor the things it what? It offers you. For when you love the what? You do not love the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure. A craving for everything, here's that word again, we see. And pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from the... Now go over to Revelation chapter 12 for a minute. I want you to see this. Verse number 3. Then I witnessed in heaven another significant event. I saw a large red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on his head. His tail swept away 1/3 of the stars in the sky. What does society like to create? Stars. Where do they like to put them? In the sky. Billboards. Magazine. But who are they following? Who controls Hollywood and the entertainment industry? Who got got control over your boy Idris? Why is the storyline behind Empire so anti-Christ? Oh, you show power? Power? What's behind what you see? I saw a great war in heaven, and the dragon tail took one third of the aim of the stars. And by the way, when you look at this word stars in the Greek, it's the word angel. I told you I'm praying, see, because you're not coming out of the world, but I want you to see who's affecting how you think, your opinion. Here's what blows me away about Facebook, and I listen to, how come sin is becoming so comfortable and normal amongst believers? I told you, people are not an enemy, but what I don't get is, how is it that we can become comfortable watching two people kiss each other of the same gender? How can we become comfortable just listening to people cuss like it's normal and we ain't got no problem with it? How can we become comfortable when we see people making fun of the church? I stopped watching In Living Color because they started making great mockery of the church. I don't watch stuff when they go against. That's why I would never watch, what's that show with your girl Kerry Washington in it? Scandal. I couldn't watch it because I don't want to get comfortable with sin. Not because I'm removed from sin, because I got to struggle with my sin. See, there's certain things you got to run away from. Not because you better than, but because you got sin in your life that you try not to make a practice of. And if you sit there and watch it and feed on it, you're going to fuel the sin you're trying to struggle with. It's not that I don't go to clubs because I can't. I go to clubs because I like it. I could cuss like a sailor. So I got to watch what I watch. Because Paul said, in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. See, there are some people you just can't. I can't hang around potheads and alcoholics. Why? Not because I beat it. See, I used to think I got it beat. But then I realized, I ain't got it beat. I just have stayed away from the environment and the people long enough so that I don't have that strength to get pulled to it. If you're going to be faithful, you can't hang around a bunch of cheating folk, because you're going to find yourself cheating too. That's why I don't get stay around a bunch of fighting people, because I'm prone to swing too. So when something pop up, I say, Lord, please help me. When a cop pulled me over one time, I said, Lord, please help me, because the radical part of me was starting to rise up. And the Lord had to show me being in handcuffs, going down to jail, and my wife bailing me out to check me. It's not that you're removed from sin. You have stayed away from the environment of practicing sin to help keep you so you won't sin. Y'all can go out here, a lot of y'all can go out here and get any man you want to, but you have enough Christ and God in you and enough fear of God and hopefully enough information that one bad move, one bad mistake, no condom, could cost you a lifetime of running into somebody that you want to marry but can't.
because you got herpes, because you got AIDS, because you got syphilis, gonorrhea, hepatitis C. See, you got to know all of it. Because God, at the moment when you're looking at it, God might not can't keep you. But if God can't keep you, hopefully your money can keep you, or information that might kill you for your life. Nah, that's all right. We got to go to the clinic. Because I don't know what you got. You don't know what I got. And anything given to you easy ain't worth having. Wait a minute. Where was I? Oh, okay, I know. Verse number 7. Then there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels, and the dragon lost the battle, and he and his angels were forced out of heaven. This great dragon, the ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, the one, watch this, the one deceiving the whole world, was thrown down to the earth with all his angels. Verse 10, then I heard a loud voice shouting across the heavens, "It has come at last, salvation and power in the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ." Watch this. Now, this is why I won't go back to the point I was making. "For the accuser of our brothers and sisters has been thrown down to the earth, the one who accuses them before our God day and night. And they have defeated him by the blood of the Lamb and their testimony. And they did not love their lives so much that they were afraid to die." Now watch this. When you and I get to the point where we always are accusing people, we're under the influence of the enemy. Because you don't have a right to accuse. That is an offshoot of being connected to the wrong source. Well, what are you supposed to do? So what you're telling me, Pastor, is I'm not supposed to discuss problems. No. I'm not telling you not to discuss problems. But most times it's not a discussion. It's an accusation. And when you and I get to the point where we stop talking about what the issue is and start accusing, well, you do this. Well, no, you do this. Well, no, you're doing this, and I know you're doing that. Now, you're in the wrong source. Because I sit and hear it all the time. People come to me. Well, you just don't know. They come to First Lady. You just don't know what. Well, what my spouse does. He does this. Now, watch this. This is what's not fair about that. The person is not there to defend himself. So to bring an accusation about somebody to me without the person, I can't listen to that. Because now you in the wrong spirit anyway. What you're trying to do is influence me to get on your side so that when I see that person, now I'm bringing what you brought me to that person. But then when you hear that person's side, now you're like, whoa, pow. How dare I not sit with both parties and hear both sides? And see, what we do in the kingdom is, watch this, in the kingdom of God is we have a friend. Simone is my friend. But we have a mutual friend, and they have a beef. But Simone beats me to her or that person, begins to tell me, and because she's my friend, now I take on her offense. Now I'm offended at this person, and that means her that person. The accuser of the brethren has influenced us again. So I want you to have to take you back to 2 Kings 6 for a minute. Now watch, what's funny about this is the number 6 is the number of man. I'm just going to go back to here for 1 second and I'm done for today. 2 Kings 6 for a minute, 6. Verse 12. 2 Kings, woo! 2 Kings had a 52 moment. 2 Kings 6,
5, grace, 6, man. Samaria. He opens up his servant's eyes. He leads them to Samaria. What is Samaria? Listen to what Samaria is for a second. I kind of said it, but I want to reiterate it. Samaria means watcher, guard, watch post, watch height, mountain. You get that? Watcher, guard. Took them to a place where they were watching. Metaphorically, it means intellectual perception, the department of the objective consciousness that functions through the head. Watcher, watch mountain. It signifies the mixed state of the consciousness. So I'm going to tell you what it means. So therefore, they take them to the place where decision has to be made, your mind. And remember the king says to Elisha, my father, should we kill him? Every time, in every situation in life, there's always going to come to you and you're going to have two views. What is the dominant view in your head? Most people in church want to kill folks. They sin. They sin. I'm better than you. You're not better than me. I pray. I fast. I do this. I do that. Why you ain't doing this? Why you ain't doing that? What do we want to do? We want to kill folks. Accuse people. Tear people down. But Elisha says no. Now watch this. He says, my father, should we kill him? Love those who persecute you. Pray for those that despitefully use you. And on top of that, if they're hungry, if they're thirsty, see, that's the spiritual way. But the carnal way might be like, if they're hungry, ignore them. If they're naked, laugh at them. If they don't have a place to eat, turn your back on them and let them fend for themselves. Because after all, I had to do it. You know what? I'm going to finish with this point, but watch this. This is what I could never understand. When I was growing up, struggle was like the badge of honor in the black community. You know, your mama or auntie would say something like this, well, I would help you, but I had to struggle, so I'm going to let you struggle too. Man, you know how hard I had to work in college, so you know what? I would give you more money, but why don't you get a job, because that's what I had to do, and you learn how to struggle too. You ever heard that? But then, when I worked at the law firm, I noticed something. That ain't how white people do their kids. You know, it tripped me out one time. One of the lawyers said, man, my kid ran up this debt, and I just paid it off. Like, you paid off his debt? Then I started doing clean, started doing the same thing too. Then I started knowing that Spanish people do that too. And I said, God, why is it that as black people, we the only ones that don't do that? When did we get this thing that the badge of struggling is supposed to be the way we spoke? Now, I understand we need to teach people how to go through and to live and understand how to deal with suffering. But why do we always get to some place and then want to abandon people because we feel like that's the way? And what we use is this. Because we black,
We got to work harder. But harder don't mean I got to take you through, because when I see white America, they in charge of everything and don't have no debt. So even if we get there, we got so much debt, we can't do nothing. But that's what we always do. And watch this. As a man, I had to learn how, especially when you grow up by yourself and you do everything by yourself, you get used to doing everything by yourself. But then when you get help, your pride kicking and you don't want help because you're so used to fighting by yourself. You're like, that's all right, I don't need no help. Now, you ain't got no food. I just asked you, did you need something? And, oh, no, I'm fine. And 3 days later, I find out you ain't got no food in your house. Now, I just asked you, did you need something? Hey, what happened? Your pride. So when I married my wife, and my mom and dad were willing to help, I had to fight my pride to accept it, because my point of reference culturally was I was supposed to go through. But then why are you going to go through and you got help? Now, this is one of the things I'll be fighting with my son. You need something? Don't flunk and then tell me, oh, God, that drives me crazy, because I'm going to help you. I got a son right now. I'll pay for all these gym memberships. He's struggling to work out. I'm like, why won't you go to the gym? I'm paying all this money. That's what makes, what is it? Pride. It's like the man in the flood, Katrina. So the man is in his house, and the flood is at his waist. And the man rolls by in the boat, says, you want to ride? Nope, I'm believing God. So he goes up two more steps, the flood is at the top. There's another man with a boat, says, you want to ride? He said, nope, I'm believing God. So he climbs up on the roof, and the water's up to the roof. Above the roof, and the man in the helicopter comes by and says, you want to ride? He said, nope, I'm believing God. So when he gets to the pearly gates, because he done died, he said, hey, God, I was believing you to deliver me. He said, I sent three people to deliver you, but you rejected it every time. Pride will kill your ability to be able to see, because sometimes what you're praying for God to do, God will send people to help you. But we so prideful and we so full of ourselves that we not open to who God sends in our life, and they may not always be saved. And that's what Elijah shows us. Stop living based on the word. Connect your intellect to the Spirit of God and let God show you some things so you know how to operate. Don't always treat everybody. See, when you can't see, you treat people as your enemy, and they may not be your enemy. Your enemy is not people. Your enemy is the spirit of the devil. But if your eyes aren't open, you can't see that spirit. But when you can see it, then you know how to deal with it. And you don't deal with it by fighting it. You deal with it by serving. There have been a lot of people that I've worked with that did not like me and told me they didn't like me. And instead of me going toe-to-toe cussing them out, God says, serve them. Love them. Minister to them. And when you get that mindset, now God can use you. Let me share a tidbit with you, because I share this with people when they ask me, Pastor, why ain't got no job? Could be the economy, or it could be God sees an attitude in you
that he can't send you where he wants to because your attitude and mindset are not right. Because God wants people that can go on a job and serve, not be served. And until you get that mindset, God said, I'm not going to open the door for you because you got too much pride, too much arrogance. Now, it could be the economy. It could be other factors. But maybe you should pray and consider, God, is there a lot of arrogance in me? Is there a lot of pride in me? Maybe you're not getting that promotion because you got a little bit too much pride, too much arrogance, too much, well, if this is what I want to do, I'm going to do what I want to do. I don't care what nobody says. God will be like, I'm going to leave you right there. So, Lord, open their eyes and let them see. And when you have your enemies in your hand, people, don't look to crush them. Look to minister to them. Because that's why you're there. You want me to ordain you to be a minister in here? Be a minister out there. Be a minister out there. Be a minister of reconciliation out there. Be a prophet out there. Be an evangelist out there. Be a person that can show up on time, leave on time, and do an excellent job because you're trying to give glory. Because if I give you a title now with your nasty attitude, all you're going to be is a nasty deacon or a nasty minister or a nasty apostle or a nasty prophet or a nasty evangelist or a lazy prophet or a lazy evangelist or a lazy this. Or so if you ain't doing it out there, why I'm going to give you a bad and make you a lazy one in here? And you're going to represent me. And then people are going to think that's me. Come on, let's stand on our feet.